What's up everyone, April Dunnam here. In this quick tip video, I'm going to share how you can pre-populate fields in your PowerApps forms. But first, here's the intro. I'm doing this video because someone on my YouTube channel asked a question about it. And it is actually a really good use case. Oftentimes, when you're building an application that has a form element to it, there are certain fields in that form that you might not need your users to have to fill in that could be pre-populated. This could be things like the start date. A date field can be pre-populated to the current date. Or maybe a requester field can just be pre-populated to the name of the person that's filling it out. So take this form that we're seeing here for a new training. There's an instructor field, which could be pre-populated for the current user, and a date field that we can also pre-populate. So let's walk through and see how we can handle this in PowerApps. If we look at the app, this is just a form control that we have bound, in this case, to a SharePoint list called training. And we'll take a look at the easiest scenario first, which is to pre-populate this date field to the current date. Now, since this is a form control, if you want to override some of the default functionality of this, you first need to go into the data card that you want to change and unlock that. So you can click on the data card, go to advanced in the properties panel on the right, and unlock that so that we can make changes. Once it's unlocked, we can click on the date field itself, and we'll want to go to the default date property in the properties dropdown in the upper left-hand side. You'll see that in there right now is parent.default. Since form controls can be used both for new items and to edit existing items, parent.default is the default date so that if this was an edit form, it would take whatever date that you have in the form that you're surfacing up, which was already submitted, and show that here. In the case of pre-populating, you would typically only pre-populate fields on new input, not on edit. So how you accomplish this will depend on how you have your app set up. In some apps, you might have different screens and different form controls for if this is a new form or if this is an edit form. Other times, you might use the same form control. If you're using the same form control, then you need to account and only check and set this default field to the current date if the form mode is new. So what we can do here is put in an if statement, pass in the name of our form, which is form new training. And if you do a dot, we want to get the form's mode property. And you'll notice if we do a dot there, there are three different modes. There's edit, new, and view. So what we want to do is we want to say if this mode of the form equals form mode dot new, then we want to default this field to today's date in this case. So we can use the today function with an open and close parenthesis, and that will automatically default that to the current day's date. And then we'll do a comma. Otherwise, if it is a view or an edit form, then we do want to use that parent default so that it will show whatever the date value is from that existing record. And you'll see as soon as we do that, that this is pre-populating with the current date that I'm recording this video. So there's multiple ways that you can set this. So today we'll get the current date. If you wanted to do, for example, maybe you had a due date field and you wanted to automatically have the due date be 5 days, say, from the current date, you could do something like use the date add function, use that today formula in there, and do a comma and type 5, and that will add 5 days to the current date. In this date add formula, if you need to subtract days, just put a minus in front of the date and that will subtract instead of adding. So you see how it changes as I change that value. Next, let's take a look at pre-populating a person or group field value. So if we look at this instructor data card, let's first unlock it so that we can make changes. In our SharePoint list, if we open that up, this instructor field is a person or group field. So that's surfaced up in our form control as a drop-down control. This is a complex field type, so the way we have to set its default property is a bit different. So you click on the drop-down, and in the properties drop-down, you'll see two different properties that we'll want to configure. There's default, but there's also default selected items. Let's look at the default first, and you'll see there's nothing in that, but there is in the default selected items. So first of all, we'll need to do that same formula to check the mode of the form. So I'm just going to copy what we did in the date field, and we'll put that in there, and I'm just going to do parent.default for now so that it doesn't error out on us. Now to set this, you can't just go in, for example, and say hard code in someone's email address. Because you see, when we do that, it's going to throw an error because the type of data that we're passing it isn't what it's expecting. If you happen to watch my video on patching complex data types, then you probably already know what we need to do here. But if not, I'll walk through that again. So let's delete this hard-coded email, and I'm going to paste something in and I'll talk through it. So person or group fields need this type of format to be able to default and patch them correctly. The person or group field expects you to pass in the claims information, display name, and email of the user so that it'll be formatted correctly. So that's what we're doing here. And I'm just using the user function, which allows you to get the current logged in user. And I'm doing a dot email on the claims mapping, a dot full name on the display name, and a dot email again on the email field to map that. Now, I wouldn't use the user property here. What I would do instead is on your app on start, I would set a global variable called current user to that user property so that you're only getting and calling that user function once in your application, and you can use that throughout because you don't need to call that more than once. So if you have different forms or different places you're wanting to get the user information, you don't need a lot of unnecessary calls. You can do it once here, and then we can use this current user variable in our default and just swap that user out for current user. So this will really help the performance of your application, especially, like I said, if you're making multiple calls. And you'll notice as soon as we do that, it is pre-populating the instructor field with my name. So we will do this both on the default selected items and the default property. If you do this just on the default, this will not work correctly. So you have to do it on both of those properties for this to work. All right, so I'm going to show two more examples of pre-populating data. For the next two examples, I'm going to show a different way that you could pre-populate data, and that's by utilizing query string parameters. A query string parameter is just a way via a URL to pass in data to the app that you're linking to. So you've probably seen this in different URLs that you've inspected. For example, take this SharePoint URL that we're seeing. This is pointing to a training list, allitems.aspx, and then after that, you see that we have a question mark, view ID equals with a big long GUID. This is an example of a query string parameter. It's passing a query string of the view ID to the screen so that it knows which view to surface up when you hit this URL. Well, PowerApp supports these query string parameters, so we can take the URL of our PowerApp. So if you go to the make.powerapp screen, click on the details of your app, you'll be taken here and you can copy the web link of your PowerApp. And you can append a query string parameter to this, which PowerApps can then go and read and take action on. So on my SharePoint site, I've actually did this via a quick link. So I have two quick links, one for new Teams training and one for new PowerApps training. And when I click on each, you'll see that it's opening that PowerApp URL, but it's appending a query string parameter of category equals PowerApps when I click the PowerApps button. And then when I click this Teams training link, it's appending a query string parameter of category equals Teams. So what we can do now is we can take this, read this value, and then set one of our default values according to whatever we have here. So let's take a look how to make that happen. You'll want to go into your app OnStart property, and this is where you're going to read and check for that query string parameter. We'll do that using a global variable. And you define a global variable with the set command. So I'm going to set a global variable of var category 2. And now we want to get and check if there's a parameter value called category. So we can use the param function, and then you just pass it in a parameter name that you're searching for. So we're searching for a parameter called category. So what this simple formula will do is we'll look for a parameter called category, and if it's there, it's going to take whatever that value is and set that to our var category variable. Now that we have that, on the field that you're wanting to pre-populate, all you need to do is go into that field, and we'll start with this single line of text field first because they're just the easiest field types to set. Go into its default property, and again, we'll want to use that same function to check the form mode. But what we can do is we can set this, if it's a new form, to our var category field. Now, to test this out, you're going to need to save and publish your application. So let's save and publish this and see if that value is being set correctly, right? So if I go back to SharePoint now and I click on this new Teams training link that's opening up that app, this should be pre-populating our form. So I'm going to go into that form screen, and there you go. You see that category text field is being defaulted to Teams, which is the query string parameter value that we were passing, along with the instructor field and the date field being pre-populated. I'll just show you one last example of how you could pre-populate that if, say, it was a choice field. The syntax for that is just slightly different. So down here, I have a choice field type, which is a category field that has a list of categories in a choice field instead of a single line of text field. So to set its default value, you'll go into the properties pane in the default selected items. We're going to use our same check to see the form mode. And then the syntax on this, you're going to put two curly brackets and then the text value colon. And this is where you'll put in the category information. So we can use that same var category. So this will set that default value correctly. So we'll just copy this over to our default property as well. And we will save and test this. And this time, let's test clicking the PowerApps training button. We'll click the new to go to the form screen. And there you'll see our drop-down field is pre-populated with the value of PowerApps from our query string parameter. All right, so a few different ways to pre-populate your form data in PowerApps. Hope you found this helpful. If you did, please like and subscribe, and I'll catch you in the next video.